Of the day, everyone. I'm privileged to welcome you all into the third edition of Orange City Literature Festival, organized by SDR Knowledge Foundation in association with GH Raisoni University, powered by Raisoni Group of Institutions. I'm Smita Thote, delighted to be your anchor for today's session, Creating Worlds with Words by Mr. Manu Bhatri in conversation with RJ Nisha. Mr. Manu Bhatri is Keralite, settled in Bangalore. He has worked as an advertising copywriter, a journalist, and a college lecturer. He co-owns a small advertising agency. He is an author of The Town That Laughed, a novel, A Savitri Special Room, and other stories, both set in fictional town of Kathapura, and also The Oracle of Kathapura, a novel where he revisits the delightful world of Kathapura with a new cast of a memorable character and revisit the town of Kathapura that was immortalized in The Town That Laughed and Savitri Special Room and other stories. It's an honor to have you with us, Mr. Manu Bhatri, sir. And this is even more delightful as we have RJ Nisha with us, who would be in conversation with Sir as the moderator. City's favorite radio jock believes that she may be imperfect, but she is perfectly herself. RJ Nisha has been awarded as the best jock of the city, the best female jock of Maharashtra by Big FM, but she feels award the day she gets the message or call, which she, Nisha, you bring a smile to my face every morning. She follows the mantra that you only live once, but if you do it right, once is enough for. From being the best orator to winning a beauty pageant, national debater to trainer, she tried her hands on all. It's a pleasure to have your presence, RJ Nisha. Also, before moving ahead, I would like to take a moment and acknowledge the support of AS Publication, as their association is valuable to OCLF. And now, my dear audience, you are about to experience a conversation between two very dynamic individuals. So without skipping a moment, let us invite RJ Nisha to lead us ahead.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Smita, for doing this with us. And good morning, Mr. Manu. It's really an honor to meet you and to know more about.
Good morning.
You know, I belong to Radio India and I'm an RJ, as you've been just been telling about. And you have been into the field of even copy, which is also one of the very integral part of radio space, because, you know, everything just works on ads. I have a creative agency of yours. What's difficult, you know, is writing a novel or that shortest ad of 30 seconds or 40, bring up all the story in one?
These are two very different things, and it's in fact enjoyable to do them alternately, you know, kind of balances each other out. So both are pleasurable and both have their challenges also, in both ways very different too. So the pleasure of writing fiction is immense. It is a passion, you could say. Advertising writing is, you know, it's more than a passion; it's also a livelihood. So the restrictions of something being your livelihood comes with it, of course. There's a client who needs to approve what you've written. There's a market out there that needs to warm up to what you've written. There's a product, most importantly, that needs to be sold from what you've written. So advertising writing, therefore, has its restrictions compared to fiction, where you can just let go. I mean, the more you wander in your fiction, the better the quality of your writing is. Not so in advertising at all, because it starts with a brief, right? Advertising starts with a brief. Copywriting starts with one. You're already given a bracket within which to think. Yes. So on the other hand, fiction is free for your mind to wander. So that way, I would say, but then, of course, because it is free for you to wander, it is challenging also. fiction writing, because you can't, again, you have a reader at the other end. You have somebody to whom you are pitching your thoughts. So it does have its responsibilities, its accountabilities, but nothing compared to advertising. And advertising is big money. So, you know, a lot is at stake. So because of which the criticality is every day. You know, when you're writing fiction, you're writing for 8 months, 9 months, 2 years. You are in your world. You go for your morning walks. You're still writing inside your head. Whereas advertising is today, like evening, you want the copy ready, you know. So it's two different kinds of challenges, actually.
Absolutely true. So, you know, when you talk about that, something go on into your mind constantly. If you're a writer, you see things and, you know, the moment it strikes you, and you have somewhere beautifully said that, you know, that you're not that one person who thinks about a plot first and then starts writing. You're one of those person who starts writing. And once the two, three chapters are done, then you actually think, okay, fine, now I can create a special spot to it. How did you manage to do this? Because many times when we have writers across, they say that, we think of a plot first, and then after that, we think, okay, now what has to be written? You have something which is very different from the rest of the league. How do you manage to do that every time?
See, it's not all good either. I think while my writing has benefited immensely from this method, in places it has also suffered, where, you know, I stray too much. So I'm aware of that, you know, and I just get carried away in my writing. But the thing is, the pleasure of writing is felt more when it is totally, totally spontaneous, you know, when it's unrestricted by anything, even your own plot. So this I discovered when I began writing. That's I think about 5 years earlier. Before that, I used to write short stories and small stuff. But when I seriously started writing fiction to the scale of a book, when I started doing that, I discovered that I perform very well when it comes to writing. You know, as you know, writing is also a kind of performance where nobody is immediately seeing you, but eventually you are presenting yourself, you know, more than maybe some other industries. You're laying your heart bare. So in that, towards that end, this process of total spontaneity, unrestricted freedom to just do what you want, helps me. So initially, sometimes I would get a sentence in my head and I would just write it down, you know, with no clue where it's going to go next, with no clue what the next sentence is going to be. For example, even in The Oracle of Karuthuppura, my latest novel, I began with Sarasu was just 14 years old when she was possessed for the first time by Chatan, the demon god. So there is this entity called Chatan, who is a demon and a god rolled into one. This entity is there in Malayalam mythology. Okay, I did not create him, but the rest of it I created. So he's there, he's actually there, and there are these temple priests and, you know, who very much worship Chatan. So Chatan visits or possesses this little girl called Sarasu when she was just 14 years old. To be honest, I had no clue after that what happens. I just wrote that down. And then the next sentence happened. Then the next and the first paragraph happened. Then the first chapter happened. Characters just developed. And then I kind of said, okay, now I have to, you know, take stock of what's happening over here. But then it was not until the end of the second chapter that I seriously sat down to work on the plot, which greatly helped me, you know, in firstly in terms of sheer writing pleasure, and secondly also the spontaneity. I think the pace of your writing is set correctly when you don't, at least in my case, when you are not thinking of where the story is going to go next, you know, initially. But like I said, there's a negative effect also. The flip side is sometimes I end up writing, say, 4 chapters, 5 chapters of wonderful stuff, and then I have to abandon it because it's just nothing. I don't know what happens next, and I can't think of a plot properly, which fits in the characters and stuff. So if there is somebody who is a student of writing, I would say evolve your own method. This is not something I would advocate. It works with me sometimes. It may not work with you.
That's true. So you had a very beautiful journey, and perhaps, you know, being a teacher, being a journalist, being a creative writer altogether. What is that one thing which you love the most? If you had to just pick up one.
Fiction writing. There's nothing that comes close. You know, the teaching part was really very small. I just couldn't do it. You know, there are things you can do and things you can't do. So I went back to the college where I studied, and they had a vacancy. And because the principal sir knew me, he told me, "Look, this is not one of your the way you jump courses and take literature and take psychology and journalism. This is teaching. So 1 year, you please don't at least for 1 year stay here. Stay here because midterm they cannot search for another teacher." But in 6 months, I found out that I just couldn't do it. I went to sir and said, "Sir, I'm really sorry. This is something I just can't do it." And unfortunately, that did not click. Journalism, yes, I was there for 3.5 years in the Indian Express, the New Indian Express in Bangalore. It was fine, but I couldn't say there was something unaddressed in my soul when I, you know, it's not, I did not find it as exciting as I initially thought. Now, these are things you discover in due course only. So eventually, then I said, no, no more of this. And I went into advertising. Advertising had its own thrill. It was definitely because every day is new, every brief is new. The whole world of advertising is exciting. You know, it's totally it's like you're entering a place where some event is happening when you go to office. Every day there are these freaky hairstyles and funky clothes and piercings and people are all over. I lost myself completely into that. But then again, there's some part of me that did not find expression in advertising, which is why in 2016 I just sat down to write a story, and I somehow for the first time finished it, a long enough story. And a friend of mine sent it to Caravan magazine, and it was published. And from there on, it was totally unplanned, but it happened. But then I found out that passion, if you talk about, it is authoring these stories, fiction only. There's nothing else that comes close.
And I'm sure about that because one of your books, if I'm not mistaken, that The Town That Laughed was 2018's top 10 best books of the year. And if it takes you time and if you write such beautiful things, and that makes it, you know, the top 10 books of the year, so that is one of your do. So if I had to ask you about world of the words, what does that really mean to you? Really define it.
See, I was thinking of, in fact, when I was given the opportunity to talk at OCLF, I was thinking of what best to talk about. You know, there's nothing that can place me in on a pedestal from where I can talk to people who are listening to me. I'm not anyone that big or great. Okay, so then what is it that I know that I can share? What is it that I have maybe proven to some extent till now? And I thought of this topic because I have created a fictional place in my writings. It's called Karuthuppuzha. Karuthuppuzha is an imaginary place somewhere in Kerala. So I thought maybe, and critics have actually praised me time and again. They've been very kind. They have compared me with the biggies, which is very flattering, but I don't know how to react to it. They have compared me to William Faulkner, to, of course, Malgudi every time, to Macondo of Gabriel Garcia Marquez. So all I can say is I don't think I can be compared to those yet or ever. But I did reach this decision that, you know, maybe this is something I can talk about because they all compared me to the greats in this one aspect, in creating a world, in creating imaginary
Absolutely.
places. So yes, my effort has been towards that, in creating a canvas through which to present multitudes of characters, all kinds of characters. So what better than to create a small town, which is a little more than a village, but a little less than a town, you know? It's a small town in Kerala. It's called Karuthuppuzha, like I said. Karuthu means black, and Puzha means river. So Karuthuppuzha means the black river. So there is a small river running to the west of the town, The river is frothy white. The water is white as milk. But the thing is, across the river, away from the town, there are hills. And by afternoon and towards evening, the shadow of the hills start falling on the river. And the river gradually changes color. So the shadow makes the river look black towards evening. So that's why it's called Karuthuppuzha. And there are as many legends to why the name Karuthuppuzha as there are people in Karuthuppuzha. Each one creates his own version of his own mythology, why Karuthuppuzha came to be called Karuthuppuzha. So from there, I could take off and I could create a whole world, which is why I thought I should talk about creating worlds with words. So there are different aspects to this. To creating a world, it may not suit everybody's writing. It might be absolutely necessary to some forms of writing. Sticking out like a sore thumb in the case of some other kinds of writing. So I thought I'll talk about these things. That is why I chose this topic. Yeah.
So Manas, do you want us to really see, you said a place like Karuthuppuzha is one kind of those where you would love to retire.
yeah, of course. I mean, it is my dream to retire even mid-career in a place like Karuthuppuzha. Unfortunately, the desire is as imagined as the town itself. So I don't know if that will be possible someday. That certainly is my desire. Karuthuppuzha is also, I'll tell you, set in a different time frame than ours. Mm-hmm. It is located in time in the late 70s and early 80s, when there were no smartphones, when there were no laptops, and therefore the world was far more beautiful, so, if you ask me.
Absolutely.
yeah.
Absolutely so, true. I think that opinion.
Yes.
So, Manas, but say that when growing up as a kid, you have certain people who tell you stories. Or you've been hearing things around you. So, imagine words put together when you were a very simple in the age, kidding kind of a thing. But when you say when you grow up, eventually those memories stays away. That you've been hearing stories that, it helps you to sit one of those very observant people that, you love around you. And then you create them into the characters.
No, I couldn't get your question. Your voice was breaking, Nisha.
Okay.
Some problem with the...
Am I audible?
Yeah.
I was just...
You were asking me about memories. Huh.
When you grow up, you usually have some beautiful stories, beautiful imaginary world altogether. When you're someone, you just try to imagine, oh, maybe like this, this is a certain way, this way. So is it that when I think... It is that childhood memory that helps you in creating your stories.
Yeah.
Or are you a person who loves seeing people around doing different things and you think that, okay, fine, this is some character which I will introduce into my story. So what is that something that really helps you?
I would say it's a little of both. It is a little of both. I think when an imaginary place is created, the fundamental to creating worlds in your writing is memories, not just memories, maybe nostalgia even, very, very fond and overpoweringly fond memories of childhood, of the past, right? Of a place where, you were so happy that it keeps calling you to come to it again and again. So that is certainly there. So Karuthuppuzha is modeled, in fact, on a village in Kerala where we used to go during our holidays. So it is when I was maybe around in my when I was 7 years old, 10 years old, as early as that. So you know the childhood memory when you see through mists of time, you see everything is magical. It's as if the world is a fairyland. I get that feeling and that motivates me. But of course, you're right. There is this other thing also that I look at the people around me even now. And, something they say or some situation or, some way of interacting with them sometimes triggers me to create a character also. But then I always put my Karuthukuda as a background, as a foil to that person. I fit him or her into that place, and that kind of transforms the whole scenario. So it makes it, I'm enabled to create more because of that. So yes, I do borrow characters from day-to-day life around me sometimes. Sometimes from people I knew a long time ago. Sometimes people whom I have not even met, but I have heard about. So all those things do happen. And then it's an amalgam of all these things. The nostalgia and the observation comes together, and a lot of imagination is added. And that is how I come up with characters. Yeah.
So can you expect that now that I'm going to be writing something on Nisha and Smita also, because we've also been alive today?
definitely. See, that's the thing. I am like, you know, when I look at people, to me, people are amazing. Okay. I find them infinitely interesting. So the depth in a person starts revealing itself the moment you have met him or her, you know. Then when you chat with them, then when you're friendly with them. In this context, I'll also tell you one thing. I think in my world, it is very important for a writer. I've never said this before, and I'm being very bold in this case. I feel a writer shouldn't be too formal or classy or executive. A writer should be, you know, the boy next door, the girl next door, you know, the familiar with people, you know, getting to be friendly fast. Because that is what aids observation. That is what helps people, authors, you know, explore characters. So now I have met you. I have met Smita, Nisha. So for me, I don't watch out till I know you. I just open my heart so that, you know, I'm encouraging you to open your heart. And then, you know, that's the kind of friendship that kind of helps me observe people, and you never know from where the next idea comes. So the whole life of a writer that way is, I find, fun.
So Manu sir, we've actually seen that, you know, like me growing up watching Bollywood and Hollywood movies, when you talk about writers, or when they depict writers, very intense in their look. You often find them in a, you know, a cafe having lots of papers, or you keep on seeing them that they keep on writing, crushing up all the papers, and it's been thrown up. So, you know, is it really that really happens with the writers, that they keep on writing on the papers and it's being thrown in the dustbin, or writers actually don't do that?
I can talk about myself. I do that a lot. I do that a lot. I don't carry a notebook around, but I have often felt the need to carry one, you know, because you never know. There are some words you'll be always looking for. There are some thoughts, that some missing links in your plot, in somebody's character, that you've been wondering what to do with, which might occur to you at the oddest moments. So, and I'm growing old, so I'll not remember it next. You know, by the time I come back, it might go. You know, that does happen. So I've often thought of having a small notebook and a pen, but then, to be honest, I lose it. So I'll keep it somewhere and I'll misplace that. So what I do right now is my phone. I usually just email something to do with characters, etc. That happens all the time. Yeah.
So there's one thing with you, say that, you know, there has once in their lifetime decided someone publishes a book. Though this is like 90% really gets to the level that they start penning down. I think upcoming writers, which we see these days, that is somehow become very smart in giving one line stories. See about
no, we are, I can't hear you. I can't hear you.
What? You can't hear. Now can you hear me?
Yeah. What was the question again?
Okay. I was just saying that days when you see people into the creative writing, you find them, they are, you know, very smart enough. They can pen down one line stories, where you just have two line stories, and then you've got great people who are coming up with their fictional stories with the books and everything. So what do you say, where is this creative field going on? Is it that because now we're not in that era that we read very proper, now people just have a layman English being written and it's been appreciated. So how has the creative writing been transformed when you see it right now, and when you read about the other people's books also?
I think that is that's a very important decision or a choice that the writer individually has to make. So we live in a time, it's undeniable that today people don't spend time reading. Okay, so if Fyodor Dostoevsky or Leo Tolstoy is born today, I think he's going to go crazy because they are used to writing 1,000-page books. You know, the first response is such a fat book. Who is going to read this? So whether you want to go mass and, you know, have everyone read your book, or are you going to have your say and a select audience will come to you? If you're honest in your writing, if you're original in your writing, a select group will come to you, will read your book. But you cannot hope to go mass. You know, yes, there are people who write short tales, one sentence. That is another talent. That's also very skillful. But I would say it's what suits your, what you want to say the most. You know, your story. How? What is the best way to tell the story, to narrate the story that you have in your head? So that decision the writer has to take. On the other hand, I would be against, so I'm not against very short stories or anything, but I would point out that, you know, how long a story is shouldn't be a concern. I think that is technique. That comes under the whole setup of technique in your writing, which the only condition with technique in your writing is it should suit the story you're saying. It should suit your, and you have to be honest. If you're following a trend, if you see that, okay, people today don't read much, therefore let me write short stuff, that is your choice. I am not like that. So I don't stop till I stop. So I would say following trends makes writing less pleasurable to a person like me. But there are, I'm aware that there are others who do look at that. You know, there are even friends of mine who say, look, adjust a little and write something that can become a Netflix series tomorrow. So, yeah, if it comes to me, I don't mind. But if it's not coming to me, I'm not going to, you know, change my process of writing to match that. And then that's not going to be my goal. If I am to put a goal like that to my writing, then I might as well, you know, spend that time in advertising. Where anyway, that's what I'm doing. I have a product that I got to sell. So this is very different in my head. Yeah.
That's very true. Manisha, one thing about you, when you have been writing your books, it's usually said that you love to just end it in an open-end conversation. You know, it's like, yeah, I have written my way, you take it the way you want it. It's not a definite way that, okay, this is going to happen this way, this happened this way, and this goes happily ever after kind of things. You are like, now you keep thinking along with it. How do you manage to do this? Like, why is that, you know, you leave your readers along with this kind of a note that it's your job to think, boss, I have done mine by writing. So how do you, why do you do this?
Yeah, that is the way I prefer to do it. I'll tell you why. See, I read a lot of books. I read a lot of authors. I admire them. But I'm very particular about one thing, that my inspiration is always life itself. Is my life, my surroundings, my everyday, my past, my present. So I take great care, in fact, to see that what I'm doing is original. There are people I admire so much that, you know, I really don't think in this lifetime I can match them, like R.K. Narayan or you know, people I have been compared with, or Gabriel Garcia Marquez. I don't think I can. They are huge mountains and I stand at the foothills. So, but I see that my admiration doesn't amount to being too inspired. You know what I'm saying? You know, to the point that I sound like them or I'm attempting what they did. So I'm very particular that what I write is inspired by my life. So it's from the people I meet. That is why, and the one thing that I get from my life is that everything in life is open-ended. I see that nothing is conclusive. Characters, human beings, you know, ideologies, you know, something somebody says or some fights, you can't say this person is right, this person is wrong in a fight. You really can't if you go deeply enough. If you're able to say it, it's because you're not going deep enough, right?
True.
A person picks a pocket, somebody's pocket. You can't say he's entirely wrong if you go deeply enough. You know, when you identify the reasons why he is doing it. So I feel life itself is extremely open-ended. And if you are true to life in your writing will also have to be as open-ended. If you're less kind, you can call it ambiguous. You've been kind, you're saying open-ended. So, yes, but I like to keep my characters open all the time, you know, open to interpretation, open to judgment. If you, I don't want to judge them within the frame of that book. So I've written a novel where there is a woman character. A question like, is she good or is she bad in her everyday? Even that, I don't want to answer. It's up to the reader to kind of take it. So that's what I in fact, spend a lot of effort in making it that way. So
it's like, if we had to understand your writing, it's you are one of those persons who says that you can pick up my book, you can start reading, and every time you read, you'll actually interpret it in a different manner.
Absolutely.
Because you'll find something or the other thing to do it. So
yes.
In that way, you're a smart writer that, you know, we invest in your books and we can actually have a fun of reading too many books, in fact, by giving it again.
No, but I feel even even films, even movies, if you see, for me, I enjoy most the movies where the characters are open-ended and you can't directly say this is the hero and this is the villain, even, you know. To me, a great movie only has protagonists. Only has characters who keep appearing again and again, not good guys or bad guys. So yes, I keep it that way.
So, Manoj, if I had to ask you, like, you know, if there is a new upcoming kind of writer, like if you see the young teenage have their hands in writing, what are those things that they need to really understand before penning down their thoughts, or you know, knowing what has to be written and what not has to be written? Because everyone thinks of writing, but you cannot actually define it and present it in a beautiful manner. Not everyone has that kind of a talent. What would you suggest to us, you know, that how are we supposed to start with certain things if we really want to learn the art of writing?
You, when I read your bio, I found that you are not perfect, but you're perfectly you. I really love that. I think that is the greatest quality in a writer. Be yourself. It doesn't really matter whether you sell, whether you... you were talking about new upcoming writers. That's who I am. Okay. Except the teenager part. So I don't know if I can stand in a position where I can teach new writers at all. But my opinion, if you ask me, is definitely this. Be yourself. Don't read all you want. In fact, you should read, and you should be. You should have your, you know, role models. But the moment you sit down to write, be honest to yourself. Don't be in a hurry. One very unfortunate thing that I find when I go to these colleges and, you know, places where these budding authors are there and they're looking for advice, is that their question is, you know, how many words should my novel be? You know, does Aleph publish this kind of thing? Or should I go to HarperCollins for this kind of thing? So all I can say is you leave it. It's right for yourself. You know, imagine a reader sitting and reading your work and you are just telling him your story. Forget about publishing, number of words, how much money you get in royalty. You don't get anything. Okay. So forget all those things. Just focus on your writing, you know. Just sit down and write. Then if you see, the pity is that sometimes you end up losing your spontaneity because of these trivial concerns. I think your writing is nothing if it's not spontaneous. It has to just flow out of you. When you get an idea, when you get a thought in your head, don't even sit and write it immediately. Keep turning it in your head till one day you can't help writing it. It kind of gushes out of you. Then when you sit, you see the fun of writing, you know. And believe me, for small fries like us, that's all the reward, you know. I don't know if there's any great anything else waiting for us, or if there is money in this, or if this can be a career. Or these are the kind of questions younger people ask, you know. Is there money in this? Can I take this as a career? You know, they wouldn't have written their first sentence yet, but these are the concerns. So I would say, come off the all these peripheral problems and just sit down and write. And don't just sit down and write. Develop whatever is there in your head, let it reach a level of intensity so that it comes out in a burst. Then you sit down and write and you will see that it comes out of you.
So when you write down books and when you have those fiction characters which come across you, and as you said that you keep observing people also, and then you get those characters introduced into your stories, which is that one of the favorite characters, if I had to ask you, that you really loved, enjoyed, watching them and even writing about them?
You're saying the characters that I have created, right?
Yes.
That's a very, I don't know. I mean, I love all of them. But I would say the most autobiographical was Nanu in The Oracle of Karthupura. Nanu, the young guy who was always a misfit in society, could never button his shirt right, would always leave his cuffs free so that they look like wings that were flapping out. He's a very awkward guy. Very awkward. And then the worst part is that he would suddenly lose himself. He would see something, say a dung beetle or an ant, and he would just stare, and then tears would roll down. He would forget to blink. Okay, there's something in his head that is so intense, this awkward guy, that he would just look at something or the other, some leaf or something insignificant to somebody else, to the rest of the world. But to him, he would be so fascinated that he would forget to blink and his eyes would start watering. So he is my favorite guy. He would be playing with other children when suddenly he loses himself in a dream. A vision comes to him, of a train, of an engine of a train coming out of the ocean. A huge engine is coming out, steaming from the ocean, He gets this, and then he starts crying. So that's the character I would say that I really loved creating. I had to think a lot about him and about myself to create him. So that
you know, are you somewhere connected to Nanu?
I would say Nanu is me. At a certain age, at that awkward age, when you're just becoming a teenager, that's when the whole world is uncertain to you. When everything is uncertain, you don't know whether to look people in the eye. You don't know how to answer an obvious question. Would you be saying the wrong thing? So it's all, you're awkward and it comes out as you're shy. Some people think you have something to hide. There is that age when you act like a thief, but it's just that you're uncertain. You're not used to the world. Nanu feels the loneliest when he's in the middle of a crowd, because everybody's going their ways and he's like, he doesn't know where he is on planet Earth. He's totally out of place everywhere. So yes, I was at an age like that once, and I believe many people have been through that. So Nanu is someone I really enjoyed creating.
So you've been into a boarding school also, if I'm not wrong?
No, I have not been into a boarding school, no.
So is it like, those people and those students basically who have their, fantasies to write about, have you also been one of those students in your school times where teacher would love to say that, you need to write an essay on certain thing, and you were always being awarded as the best student because you could just interpret yourself so beautifully there?
See, when I was in school around 10th, 10th standard and 11th and 12th, I thought I wanted to be a doctor. I don't know why, because those days it was either doctor or engineer, or at least a lawyer. Okay, so nobody said I want to be a writer and all that. Nobody said that. Writers happened accidentally. So and you joined your literature class because you did not get good enough marks. So that was the time, really. The last of the last would go and join something like literature. Even commerce would be, you would join BCom with the goal of becoming something, somewhere. But literature is because you have to do some degree, That was my childhood, honestly. So everyone told me that I should be a doctor. I also thought I should be a doctor. So I started looking at doctors and thought, okay, everyone listens to doctors, The moment a doctor opens his mouth, you're all ears. Oh my God, what is this guy going to say now? Am I going to live or die? So doctors struck me as very important people. I thought, okay, this is not a bad idea. Let me try to be a doctor. The problem is I later realized that I like to be a doctor, but the way to becoming a doctor, I don't really enjoy. So I did not really like biology. I can't memorize things, you know.
So, I so wish if there was another method to become a doctor, even I would have become one too.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I couldn't take it. So at that time, my whole orientation was towards medicine and entrance exams and stuff, which was very wrong for a person like me, I guess. I realized it many years later. But because of that, I did not really focus much on my English literature and stuff. Okay. So during exams, my teacher used to tell me, her name was Miss Muralidhar. Muralidhar ma'am used to tell the class itself, you know, Manu's essays just go on and on. He doesn't care about word limit, nothing. But it's such a pleasure to read. Okay. And yeah, but then I would be sitting there thinking, I wish my biology teacher said this, you know, something like that. Or my chemistry teacher, because that's my goal, right? This is just a side business. I never really realized that I'm good at this at all. So I used to use new words. I was experimenting with words, all as though that is a hobby. Never like that would be something I would want to do in life. Mm-hmm. But then fortunately, I did not get anywhere. Luckily, all medical colleges rejected me. So I went and joined BA Literature. But that is when I realized this is something I love doing. I read Shakespeare first, Macbeth. I read that and I thought, anyone can write this? What is this? Why do they keep saying Shakespeare? So I went and asked my professor, sir, what is so special about Shakespeare? I don't get it. So my professor told me, you do one thing, read Macbeth 10 times more, not just once, you know, 10 times or 15 okay. times, and then you come back, then we'll discuss. I read that and then the juice started flowing in, you know. Then I said, oh, okay, you can't replace one word in that whole thing with another, you know. It's all like, it's perfection and greatness. Then I started liking literature. And that is when I knew, oh, all right. So those answers that I wrote those days, I should have pursued that. Okay, now it's not too late. And that is when I wrote my first short story and it appeared in the Indian Express newspaper. And then I used to write even at that time, but they were all small little middles in the edit page. So that is when my writing was first noticed. After that, of course, I joined advertising and all I wrote was headlines for ads for some, say, 15 years. After that, I took up fiction again, and that is when I started writing books.
But you know, when I was searching for your pictures on net, I did not find any of your pictures where you look like those typical piercing and, you know, colored hairs and wearing those funky t-shirts there and having those kind of a one cigar into their hair, you know, pierced, kept here on the ear. I couldn't find any of those. So how did you always manage up to be so sophisticated, being into a copywriting business also? Because we are not like that.
Because, see, Nanu might grow up, but he's still awkward. I've never felt the need, in fact, you know, do anything. In fact, in advertising, people used to tell me that I looked the least like a copywriter. I used to dress up in a shirt. You know, nobody wore shirts there. It would be a t-shirt that's preferably torn here and there. That was the uniform in ad agencies. But for me, it was always the way I was in college and school. I used to just continue that. So I've always...
How did you actually meet up your crush of the life or the love of your life? Was it because you also gave her a love letter, writing out all those love stories of yours? Or... she read something of you and she said, no, this is the man I want to get married to, because he will not utter a word in the house. He will just be busy in writing.
Not really. I think I chased her to such an extent that she said, you know, it's less disturbing to just marry him. No, actually, we met in college and no, love letters did not happen. I couldn't get myself to write a love letter ever. But the love for literature was a common ground always. So she was also a literature student. She's now an English teacher. And she's always my first reader. After I write something, she has to approve it or I rewrite. So it's like that. So that the beginning of that was in college when we were dating. So that time, no, there were no love letters that happened at all. I don't know if I impressed her with anything except my persistent openness as I'm doing now. Apart from that, there was nothing else. And it happened, and we are still happy together. So
does it happen that your chemistry between what you share with her reflects up into your writings at times? Because you always take an inspiration from the things around you. And as you say that, you have people in your life who really inspire you at times. So does it happen that when your character somewhere is stuck, you look up to her and you say that, man, she's just giving me an idea and I think I should actually be doing something like this?
Very much. Does that happen with you? Yes, time and again, very much. Many of the stories that I've written and the two novels and even the third book that's coming out now, many of those, the characters have been inspired by some stray dialogue from her mouth. You know, we were walking on the terrace when she said one day, there was a, in her place in Kerala, in her village, there used to live an old aunt called Sarasu. Sarasu used to get possessed by Chatan once in a while. So she said that casually, and then she laughed and said, you know, the thing is that, you know, whenever Sarasu didn't have money or whenever people did not listen to her, that is when she got possessed. Okay, so her possessions were always with some intent in mind. So then that set me thinking, and that is how I came up with the first. Only thing is that I shifted the old aunt to a 14-year-old girl. My character, I even named her Sarasu. So that is when, like I said, I wrote that first sentence. Sarasu had just turned 14 when she was possessed for the first time by Chatan, the demon god. So yes, it is when Reshmi, her name is Reshmi, it is when Reshmi says something like that, that many of the characters have formed themselves. So yes, that does inspire me, and it helps because she is a literature student too. Because she reads a lot, so the odd characters in her life are also as interesting as in my life. So yes, we do compare notes.
Part of your conversation, because you know, I too was a literature student, and the only worst part is that I didn't get married to a literature person. So when I expressed out my into a poetic manner, the first thing I got to read after my marriage was, I couldn't understand what you wrote there. It was like, yeah, I could not understand what does it mean. You write in such a literary manner. And that was the day I said, I lost my writing now because I can't write to a person.
No, that does happen. I believe. Yeah.
So that's a part where, you know, it's blessed that, you know, a doctor getting married to a doctor and a literature student getting married to a literature student, because you can share a common platform of your books.
Absolutely.
And yes. When people say that, you know, we've been living about 3 days, and now when they read about your stories in a way, what do you really feel that, you know, that you really have that feeling that, fine, that anything which is being compared to my...
No, your voice is breaking again, Nisha.
What? I am some... Okay. Let me try it again.
No. Can you... Yeah.
Stuck, actually.
Okay. Yeah, what was the question again?
Right. So when people are comparing you with the fictional characters, Malguri Days and Alkin Narayan, so does that really make you know that you have attained a level people now consider for?
Or not really.
You get feared with, you know, now more things to write on?
Not really. I don't, apart from a little bit of coyness about being compared to the greats, I don't really take it too seriously, because I think every writer's pursuit is different. So, in fact, it set me thinking when the last review had compared me to, I think, William Faulkner or somebody. And then it set me thinking, why do we do this at all? Why do we create imaginary places at all? You know, why don't we take, for example, why doesn't every author simply set a real place as his background, as her background? Why do authors create imaginary places at all? And then I thought that, you know, the reason I create imaginary places might be very different from the reason why some other author would. So it's wrong to compare that. You know, yes, in terms of stature, in terms of realism, in terms of creativity and imagination, you might compare two authors who created two different imaginary places. But that apart, the intent behind it would be very different. So I don't feel much about it at all. Incidentally, I was thinking actually that, you know, the reason authors create places is because escaping into places, into lands, moving is something very, very basic to us. It is something that has been with us since lakhs of years, since human beings began, you know, in forests or wherever they were. Human beings were always wanderers. They would be moving for, you know, miles and miles. Before we spoiled ourselves by inventing agriculture, we used to just wander. We would finish resources in one place, finish not in today's sense where we finish for good, finish in a way that things would grow back. But in the meantime, we would move to another place, another clearing, hunt animals there, eat fruits there, then again move on. So this movement is has become very intrinsic to us. It is the desire to move, to go from place to place, to go to strange lands, to go to places where you haven't been before, is very, very fundamental. And that is why I think we still create, what better than to completely create a place itself, a place that doesn't exist, so that you can never actually reach there, but always go towards it. You know, I feel that is why I create places. I think it's a very basic need for me.
Okay, okay. So I have a quick rapid questions for you. You need to answer them, not in less than 1 second, if you could say.
Yeah, yeah, I can do that. But your voice, your connect, there's something wrong with the connectivity.
Now is it okay? We lost you for some time, but we could just hear you in the meantime.
Is it? Okay, okay, okay. Yeah, you can ask me. Let me.
Now it's fine.
I just want to say something, dear sir and ma'am. Want this interesting conversation should end, but like we have already exceeded the time span.
Okay, okay. That means
okay. Okay, so I'll take one last question, Smita. I'm not asking more time from you.
Oh, sure.
What is it?
An
evening spent with a stranger having coffee and creating a or is it a choice of hearing your face sitting in the corner of your room and creating a story?
No, I couldn't hear that.
Okay.
Please, could you repeat that?
Now, okay.
Yeah.
Like, is Manu sir one person who would love to spend an evening with in a cafe with a stranger and having coffee, or is he a person who's actually going to have it new in the corner of the house and start writing? So who is Manu?
I think the latter. I would like to sit quietly in one corner and write. I don't too many people around. And in life, I like to be with people and, you know, I like to be in conversation with people. During writing, no. Definitely sit in a quiet corner, preferably dim lights, and just look at my monitor, and that's the kind of person I am.
How sweet. So thank you so much for your journey with us. It was great knowing you and looking forward to the books coming in.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure. I thank OCLF for this platform and our viewers also for taking time out and listening to us. Thank you, Smita. Thank you. Thank you, Nisha also. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Manu sir. Smita, over to you.
Yeah, Smita.
At the outset, I would like to thank Mr. Manu and RJ Nisha for joining us today. We wish we get to hear you both again. We will be equally enlightened as well as are we today. And for my dear massive audience, I'm sure witnessing this conversation, you all are taking home an enriched version of yourself, just as I will. Thank you for joining us today. And I see you again. This is Smita Dhote signing off.